All right, we're going to pick up talking about the dictionary example that we gave an overview of on Wednesday. Just to refresh our memory on how it works, it's a little AJAX application to allow you to look up a mathematical term in English and then show the translation into Spanish. I accomplished this via some hard-coded arrays, but we could just as well do this on a database. Even with the hard-coded arrays, it's probably something that I wouldn't necessarily want to load up the entire array, because it would make the page a lot bigger initially. So this is a good candidate for an AJAX application. Wait for the projector here to warm up, and we'll refresh our memory on how this works. It has a size attribute, though, that allows you to see more than one row at the drop-down at the same time. So that might look a little unusual, but it's really just a drop-down like anything else. As I type in, with each successive character, it narrows the list down further and further. I select the one that I want, click Go, and it gives me the Spanish translation for it. As I mentioned last week, there's actually two AJAX requests going on here. The one that populates the dropdown, and the other that pulls the Spanish translation. So there's going to be essentially two of everything. There's going to be two XML HTTP objects. There's going to be two callback functions. There's going to be two requests made. There's going to be two PHP scripts that get called, two of everything. All right. We're going to examine this a couple different ways of doing it, specifically talking about how the server returns the data to the client. So far, we've talked about the data being returned to the client in terms of a delimited data, So if you think of the quiz example that we went before, we gave the results of the quiz in terms of whether they got the question right or wrong as a series of Y's and N's separated by commas. Delimited means that the data is separated by something. So you can tell each piece of data based on there's a delimiter that defines, you know, what's one piece of data, what's another piece of data. And in our case, we used a comma in the quiz example. And we put a comma between the Y's and N's to indicate whether they got the question correct or incorrect. All right. Data can be delimited any number of ways. Can with a comma, with a tab, with semicolons, periods, any sort of punctuation. The only restriction is that you can't use something as a delimiter if it's going to appear in the data. So, for example, couldn't use a space as a delimiter because there's a piece of data that actually contains a space. So I couldn't separate pieces of data in this example using a space, because a space is a legal character that could be part of data. So whatever you choose as a delimiter can't be part of the data at all. All right. So what we're going to do is we're going to look at this. I'm going to sort of give you, I'm going to try to give you an overview of all the pieces. And then we're going to drill down and look at each piece individually to see how this goes together. Now, the one aspect of this is in the different versions of this that we're going to explore, this piece stays the same. In other words, the function that takes, once you've chosen something from the dropdown and selected it, that piece is the same in all three examples. So we'll only go over that once. All right. What's really different is the manner in which the dropdown is populated. That we do three different ways with three different kinds of delimited, three different kinds of data formats. Not delimited data, but three different kinds of data formats. We use delimited data, we use XML data, and we use JSON data. And each one of those provides some unique benefits. And we'll explore and we'll discuss briefly the advantages and disadvantages of it. So, let's take an overview of this, and then we'll drill down and look at each piece of it in more detail. All right, so here is the HTML that contains a JavaScript that does the AJAX thing. And you'll notice that we actually have two HTTP requests, HTTP and HTTP2. That is, we have two XML HTTP requests. Each one of those gets created by the same function. Again, an advantage of using a function, right, is we need two of them, so we don't have to duplicate this chunk of code. We can simply call the code twice. So that creates our first object. This creates our second object. Now again, really, I probably should put this chunk of code either in an include file, or I could put it in an external JavaScript file, because this code really doesn't change no matter what. All right, this code I'm going to use in all my AJAX examples, so it probably would be better if I put it in a separate file. That way, if something did change a little bit, if there was a new browser that came out, for example, that had a slightly different rule for creating that XML HTTP object, I could accommodate it in just one place, and I wouldn't have to go around tracking down all my AJAX code. So, I should probably put this in an external file. All right. It is nice to be able to see it all at the same time, but it would be better programming practice to have this in its own file. All right. The two user events that trigger the AJAX action is one is the onKeyUp event, and the other is the onClick on the button. So the onKeyUp is what, as I'm pressing, all right, after I've pressed a key, it goes and it retrieves the values for the dropdown. Now, I could have done this on key down, but it would always be one letter behind. So as I typed in HI, it would show me the words that started with H. And if I typed in HIG, it would show me the words that started with HI, and so on down the line. So the letter doesn't get put really in the text box until you lift the key. That's a good question. If you're ever on Jeopardy and you're on JavaScript events, that would probably be a $500 question, I would think, because that's pretty tricky. When does a character get put in the text box? And it's when you lift the key. So on key up event. All right. So on key up event, I call get words, and I pass it this dot value. Now, this dot value is sometimes confusing to students when they see the word this. What does this mean? Yes?
The element, whatever it's contained in.
Yeah, exactly. When it says this, it means whatever element that this instruction is part of. So, This on key up is an event on the text box. So it's hard to say this without using the word this a bunch of times. But in this particular case, this means the text box itself, because the code is part of the text box. So if I said this as part of the button, code associated with the button, then this would refer to the button. So this refers to whatever object that piece of code lives at or lives on. And in this particular instance, that code is part of the text box object, text box element. So when I say this.value, I mean the value of the text box. Now, that's sort of a shorthand, right? I could have said, I could have given this an ID and said, get words, document, get element by ID, so on. I could have written this a number of different ways. All right. Or I could have had this function had no argument and appear then in get words, I could have pulled the value of the drop box or of the text box. But I didn't. All right. So essentially what this does is when I lift the key, it calls the function getWords, and it passes the value of the text box to it as an argument. Well, let's see what getWords does. GetWords, first of all, looks to see if there's nothing in the string, or the first character is equal to a space. If it's either of those, then it clears out what's there before. How does it clear out what's there before? Well, it grabs a pointer to the dropdown, and it sets the length of the options to 0. So far in this course, we've created HTML dynamically, in many cases by using inner HTML. We're going to actually, in this example, explore the DOM a little bit more. And we're going to access other attributes of our HTML elements. So, for example, in this case, we're grabbing a dropdown, and dropdowns have a collection of options. All right? One of the attributes of a dropdown is the number of options it has. And if I set the length of the options to 0, that effectively clears out all the options from the dropdown. So this is not an AJAX function. This does not require doing anything to the server. This is something I can handle completely on the client side. Because if there's nothing in the text box, I don't want to show anything in the dropdown. So let me show you what I mean. If I start out and I have something in the text box, as I clear it out, when I clear out the last letter, it totally blanks out the dropdown. And that's this piece of code that does that. I grab a pointer to the dropdown. I then set the length of the number of options to 0. So remember, a dropdown is really a collection of options, right? If you remember what a dropdown looks like, it's a select tag, and there's a whole bunch of option tags nested within the select tag. All I'm saying is change the number of options, the length of that list of options, to 0. So that effectively clears out all the options. Now notice also, and again, sometimes these examples are written at different points in time, so the coding looks a little different. Sometimes I leave the coding different simply to show you that there's more than one way to reference something. Notice that I'm not using the workhorse get element by ID here. All right? I'm saying document FRM Math, DD Words. Well, document, again, means somewhere on the web page. FRM Math means part of the form. And then finally, DD Words is the name of the dropdown. So I don't have an ID on the dropdown. I refer to it by name. So this is a second way of referring to an element on the page. You can give document dot the name of the form, and then give the name of the form element. Again, just two different ways. Neither of them are superior. It's good to know a couple different ways to do things, though, just in case you're reviewing examples and you see someone doing it one way or another. You know, it would kind of be like, you know, if I were to give an address, you know, if someone were to ask me where is Lorain County Community College, I could give them the address. I could say 1005 Abbey Road, Elyria, Ohio. Or I could give the latitude and longitude, right? It's not pointing to two different colleges. Both those things point to the same college, to the same location. It's just two different ways to refer to a particular point in space. Get element by ID and using the form name and the element name is simply a different way to refer to the dropdown. I could have just as well given that form element an ID and said document get element by ID and then supplied the value of the ID. So in both cases, I am pointing to the dropdown. And specifically, I am setting the length of the dropdown to 0 if there's nothing in the text box. If there is something in the text box, though, I call dictionary1.php and I pass on the query string a value of word, and I supply the argument that was entered. What's the argument? Well, the argument, if you remember, is the value of the text box, right? Because when we called this function, we passed it the value of the text box. So if there's nothing in the text box, we clear out the dropdown. If there's something in the text box, we make our AJAX request to dictionary1.php and we give on the query string with the name of word, we give the value of the text box. I then set the callback function to create DD. So in other words, when the server has responded, create DD gets called. And then I go ahead and actually make that request. So I'm going to I'm going to review some of the debugging techniques. How do I know what gets called from the server to the server? I can put an alert here and say alert and simply display this value. And I can actually see what is getting called on the server. It's important to do debugging techniques like this as opposed to just staring at your code, because otherwise you can make some pretty wrong assumptions about what's wrong. Don't be so sure that you know what's wrong if your code isn't working, right? A lot of times people think they know what's wrong and head down a certain path in debugging when really the problem is someplace else entirely. So when you're debugging, keep an open mind and verify that stuff is working the way that you think it should. And at some point you're going to find something that is not working the way that you think it should, and that's where your problem is. So I'm going to go in and I'm going to move over this guy to my server. And as I type in a letter, there's my alert. showing that what gets called is dictionary1.php ?word equals A. I type in B and it shows that. So that's what's getting called from the server to the server. All right, I'm going to get rid of that alert because otherwise it'll drive me crazy. Dictionary1.php ?word equals followed by the string that I've entered in. Let's see what that produces when I call it. Remember, as a debugging technique and as a development technique, I can actually put in the URL up in my browser and see the results that's going to be generated. So, dictionary1.php ?word equals A. Let's see what gets returned. And we see we get some data. And let's check out the data that we get back from the server. We get back a word followed by a number. And we get back actually a bunch of these. In this case, we have 26 things, actually 27 things we got back. These are all the words that start with A. So, we get back a word, followed by a semicolon, followed by a number. And we'll see what that represents, and we'll see how that gets created in a minute. But just notice now that the word, semicolon, number, colon. So this is the limited data. All right? This actually has two delimiters. It has a colon and a semicolon. The colon is used to separate the list of words. All right? So, that is one word up to the colon. That is another word. That is a third word. The semicolon is used to separate the word itself from the index of the word, the number of the word. All right? We're going to use that number later on when we pull up the Spanish translation.
So, I just wanted to, so I can make sure I get this straight. So, you're delivering, each cluster has two components, correct?
Yes.
And you're separating each cluster via the colon.
Each cluster is separated by a colon. Within a cluster, the individual fields are separated by semicolons.
So where are you implementing that colon or kind of cluster separation?
Well, we haven't seen that yet.
Okay.
Yeah, we haven't seen that yet. We're just looking at the output. And to just verify that, in fact, that this is delimited data. Because, again, as we can see here, we're getting back data that's separated by special characters, special delimiters. And our next step will be to look to see how this data is created. Our step after that will be to see how it gets parsed to form the dropdown. Okay, so that's the data that we're getting back from the server. Let's look back at the server code. Remember, that's dictionary one. First thing we have in here is we have an include file. Why do we need an include file? Why do we need an include file? What I just did there should have given you a clue as to why we need an include file. How many steps is it to get a translation? Two. Look up the word. Click for the translation. So there's going to be two pieces of server-side code that handle this transaction. One piece gives me the list of words. So as I type in something, it gives me a list of words. So that's one PHP script that does that piece. A second PHP script does this piece. I better make sure that both of those are looking at the same list of words, right? Because if part one had one list of words and part two had a different list of words, then this would never work. All right, so I better make sure that these two are looking at AJAX or server code 1 and server code 2 are looking at the same list of words. So those two things have a list of words in common. Common code in PHP means an include file. So let's look at what the common code is. Let's look at that dictionary.inc. And that dictionary.inc is two arrays. A English and A Spanish. And there's 200 some in each array. This is where I was saying before that I wouldn't want to send all this over via JavaScript. And if you can imagine, if we were going to do a more complete, not just a mathematical terms, but a more complete English to Spanish dictionary, would have many, many more words in here and would probably involve a database. These are what are called parallel arrays. What do I mean by a parallel array? I mean that the array elements line up. So for example, the first English word is absolute value. So that has an index of 0. Because remember, with arrays you start with 0. So absolute value is in the 0 position in the English array. The Spanish translation of it El valor absoluto is also in the 0 position. So I create these arrays so that the values in the English array correspond to the value in the Spanish array, all the way down the line. So the second element in the Spanish array is la exactitude. and I know I'm probably butchering the Spanish pronunciation. But element one in the English array is accuracy. Element three in the English array is addition. In the Spanish array, it is la adición, and so on down the line. So that's called parallel arrays, when you have two arrays where the elements of the array line up exactly. So the 10th element in this array matches up with the 10th element in that array. That's called a parallel array. Yes?
Could you make like a class for that and then have the property be like English and then another property be Spanish?
Absolutely. A more full-blown solution, if we were going to do a more robust version of this, we could make a class for mathematical term. And then what we could do is we could have all sorts of attributes for that. We could have the English name for it. We could have the Spanish name for it. We could have the French name for it. We could have a definition in English, Spanish, and French. We could have examples of how it's used, you know, in mathematical expressions, not in words. So, absolutely, if we wanted to do a more involved version of this, you creating classes and integrating with the databases would be the way to go on that. Absolutely. But this is a simple data structure that will get us through a simple example. All right. So now I think we can see what that number is. So in other words, if I go in and type, remember when I pulled up the server-side code, that number is the position in the array. All right? So if I type in R, for example, radius is in position 318 in the array. Root is in 319, ration is in 320, rational 321, and so on down the line. So this is returning, when I type in a string, this is returning the English word and the position in the array of the English term, which also happens to be the position in the array of the Spanish version of the word, because those are parallel arrays and the indexes in those two arrays match up. So let's look at the code that does that. We have our include file with our two arrays. We grab from the query string the request of word. I set a boolean that says we have found none, and I set that to true, right? I'm going to display a special message if some goofy string is typed in and nothing is returned. So if I were to type in something like that, I get a message that says no word matches this pattern and a negative one as the index. What's significant about negative one? Well, negative 1 doesn't match up with any of the arrays. You start numbering the array with 0. So my code can use the negative 1 as a signal to say negative 1 means that this is not, there are no words to match this string. And we'll see how that comes into in a minute here. So what do? We assume that there's none, and we're going to keep that assumption until we find one. We loop through the English array for I equals 0. That will look at the first element. We do this as long as I is less than the count in A English. So we do this as long as there are more array elements, and we increment I by 1 each time. I then do a comparison, and I use the strpos function. We'll see what that does in a minute. looking for, I'm looking at each element in the English array, and I'm looking for within that array the string that I've typed in the text box. And I'm looking to see if that equals zero. If it does equal zero, and let's forget about the details of what this line of code does for now. This is looking for a match, and I'll explain what this line of code does in a second here. So if there's a match, then I output the English word and the subscript. I put a semicolon between the English word and the subscript. I put a colon after the subscript. So, that's what I output. I loop through. If there's a match, I output the English word, a semicolon, the subscript, and then a colon. And then I repeat this for every element in the list. I then set bNone to false because I have a winner. I have a match. All right. If it makes through the whole loop and it doesn't find any, then I output no words match this pattern and a negative one. So if I type in something that is not valid, that's what I get.
What if you just type, like, say, 8B, but it's still not bringing back anything as far as just think of absolute values, you just put a B?
If I type in AB,
yeah.
It okay. Gives me just the one match. Okay. So, we loop through the array. We compare what was typed in the text box with the array element to see if it's a match. If it's a match, we output it, and we set our flag to zero. If we've made it through the whole array and it didn't find any matches, I output that. Now let's look at this instruction in a little more close. This is our condition. Alright. STRPOS is looking for a string in a position. So what this is doing is this is looking at the word in our English array and seeing if the position of the substring is zero. So let's go over a few examples. Let's say my words are absolute value addition and crab. All right. remember, because this is in a loop, it executes one iteration for each element. Let's say these are my only three words in my array list. If I type in an A, let's add one more. Multiply. If I type in an A, what it's going to do is it's going to try to find a position of A in each of my array items. And it's going to return a number. So where does it find A? Where's the first occurrence of A in absolute value? Very first letter, which you should be used to this by now, is actually not letter number one, but letter zero. So this function, string position of this word, looking for the substring of A, is going to find the A in position zero. So, I look to see, does that position, where did it find A? Did it find it in position zero? That's what the equal sign says. The position where it found that substring, does that equal to zero? If it does, we have a winner. Now, your eyes are not deceiving you, and I haven't lost my mind because it's Monday or anything. There really are three equal signs here. And we'll come back to what that means in a second. Essentially, it's looking to see if that equals a zero. But I'll explain in a minute why the three equal signs instead of the two. So, string position, in other words, where is the A in the first word? Is in the first letter, which is letter number zero. So that's a match, because the position of A in absolute value, the position of the first A in absolute value, is zero. Where is the position of the first A in addition? Same thing, zero. Where is the position of the A in crab? Yeah, position 0, 1, 2. So position 2. What about in multiply? Nowhere. So this is where PHP gets funky. All right? It actually returns a false, which, if I'm not mistaken, corresponds to a negative 1. But in other words, it didn't find A at all in there. All right? So, which words are the winners here? Which words are there a match? This one, because the position is zero. This one, because the position is zero. Crab is not, because it found it, but it didn't find it in position zero. So it's not valid. And multiply, it did not find it either. So, it's also a loser. So if these are my two, if this was my list of English words, and I typed in an A, it would give me these two. All right? What if I typed an AB then? Where does it find AB here? Position zero. AB starts in position zero. Where does it find AB here? It doesn't. Where does it find AB here? It's in position 2. Where does it find AB here? False. So, of these values, only one of them equals 0, so we only have one winner. So that way we narrow it down with each step, and we only pick the things that match. So what this does is this finds where this string begins in this string. If it doesn't find it, it returns false. If it finds it, it returns the starting character number starting with zero. So in this case, AB starts in position 0. Here, it's not there at all. Here, AB starts in position 2. Here, it's not there at all. We know we have a match if the starting position is 0, because that means that whatever I've typed in here is right at the beginning of the word, which is what we want if we're looking up a word in a dictionary. We don't, if we're looking up a word in a dictionary and it starts with AB, we don't care about crab, because if we wanted to find crab, we'd type in CR, right? So, that's how this, each time through narrows it down. And then what happens when it has an output? It outputs. The word, a semicolon, and the element of the array, this being I0, I1, I2, I3, the position in the list. Now, where do the three equal signs come from? PHP uses equal signs for different things. An equal, a single equal, indicates an assignment. So if I say x equals 5 times 10, takes 5 times 10, multiplies it, and puts the result in x. So a single equal sign is used for assignment. Two equal signs are used for comparison. So if I were to say if x is equal to 50, then do something. It's going to compare x to 50 and tell me either true or false. Three equal signs are also used for comparison. The difference is with a three equal sign comparison, it has to match the value and the type. All right? In other words, a true or false, you can do a numeric comparison in PHP, and true ends up being like a 1 and false ends up being a 0, or maybe true is a 1 and false is a negative 1, or something like that. PHP actually converts true and false and stuff like that into integers. So if you use the two equal signs, it does a conversion and converts true or false into values, numeric values. If you use the three equal signs, you are saying don't do any conversion. The value has to match, and the type has to be the same. So don't convert a true or false into a number. All right? So effectively, what I'm saying is it really has to be 0 and not a false that got converted to a 0. Alright? So the 0 simply indicates in PHP to do the comparison and pay attention to the type. Don't do any conversion. Alright, I look at the time and it is 9:55. Alright? So that's where we'll leave off today. All right? So what we have is we sort of have the first part of the server-side code done. We've made the request. We've processed it on the server side and returned back to the client the limited data. What we'll go over next time is this function here, which sort of got into your question, David, of what do we do with that data? And that's what createDD does. CreateDD takes that delimited data and performs an operation called parsing. What is parsing? Parsing is when you take a big string of data and separate it out into its pieces. So we're going to parse that big old string, because what we're getting back from the server, remember, is just a giant string. We have to take that and break it down into the clusters, as you called them, and then break each cluster down into a word and a number. And that's what we do on the client side, and we'll look at that on Wednesday. All right. And I realize now I was just pointing to something on the screen when the screen wasn't up, but you can take a look at the HTML and see that chunk of code, and we'll spend some time on Wednesday reviewing that. All right, see you over in lab. All right, we're going to pick up talking about the dictionary example that we gave an overview of on Wednesday. Just to refresh our memory on how it works. It's a little AJAX application to allow you to look up a mathematical term in English and then show the translation into Spanish. I accomplished this via some hard-coded arrays, but we could just as well do this on a database. Even with the hard-coded arrays, it's probably something that I wouldn't necessarily want to load up the entire array, because it would make the page a lot bigger initially. So this is a good candidate for an AJAX application. Wait for the projector here to warm up, and we'll refresh our memory on how this works. Have a text box, have a drop down. This actually is a drop down. It has a size attribute though that allows you to see more than one row at the drop-down at the same time. So that might look a little unusual, but it's really just a drop-down like anything else. As I type in, with each successive character, it narrows the list down further and further. I select the one that I want, click Go, and it gives me the Spanish translation for it. As I mentioned last week, there's actually two AJAX requests going on here. The one that populates the dropdown, and the other that pulls the Spanish translation. So there's going to be essentially two of everything. There's going to be two XML HTTP objects. There's going to be two callback functions. There's going to be two requests made. There's going to be two PHP scripts that get called, two of everything. All right. We're going to examine this a couple different ways of doing it, specifically talking about how the server returns the data to the client. So far, we've talked about the data being returned to the client in terms of a delimited data, in terms of delimited data. So if you think of the quiz example that we went before, we gave the results of the quiz in terms of whether they got the question right or wrong as a series of Y's and N's separated by commas. Delimited means that the data is separated by something. So you can tell each piece of data based on there's a delimiter that defines, you know, what's one piece of data, what's another piece of data. And in our case, we used a comma in the quiz example. And we put a comma between the Y's and N's to indicate whether they got the question correct or incorrect. All right. Data can be delimited any number of ways. Can with a comma, with a tab, with semicolons, periods, any sort of punctuation. The only restriction is that you can't use something as a delimiter if it's going to appear in the data. So, for example, couldn't use a space as a delimiter because there's a piece of data that actually contains a space. So I couldn't separate pieces of data in this example using a space, because a space is a legal character that could be part of data. So whatever you choose as a delimiter can't be part of the data at all. All right? So what we're going to do is we're going to look at this. I'm going to sort of give you, I'm going to try to give you an overview of all the pieces. And then we're going to drill down and look at each piece individually to see how this goes together. Now, the one aspect of this is in the different versions of this that we're going to explore, this piece stays the same. In other words, the function that takes, once you've chosen something from the dropdown and selected it, that piece is the same in all three examples. So we'll only go over that once. All right. What's really different is the manner in which the dropdown is populated. That we do three different ways with three different kinds of delimited, three different kinds of data formats. Not delimited data, but three different kinds of data formats. We use delimited data, we use XML data, and we use JSON data. And each one of those provides some unique benefits. And we'll explore and we'll discuss briefly the advantages and disadvantages of it. So, let's take an overview of this, and then we'll drill down and look at each piece of it in more detail. All right, so here is the HTML that contains a JavaScript that does the AJAX thing. And you'll notice that we actually have two HTTP requests, HTTP and HTTP2. That is, we have two XML HTTP requests. Each one of those gets created by the same function. Again, an advantage of using a function, right, is we need two of them, so we don't have to duplicate this chunk of code. We can simply call the code twice. So that creates our first object. This creates our second object. Now again, really, I probably should put this chunk of code either in an include file, or I could put it in an external JavaScript file, because this code really doesn't change no matter what. All right, this code I'm going to use in all my AJAX examples, so it probably would be better if I put it in a separate file. That way, if something did change a little bit, if there was a new browser that came out, for example, that had a slightly different rule for creating that XML HTTP object, I could accommodate it in just one place, and I wouldn't have to go around tracking down all my AJAX code. So, I should probably put this in an external file. All right. It is nice to be able to see it all at the same time, but it would be better programming practice to have this in its own file. All right. The two user events that trigger the AJAX action is one is the onKeyUp event, and the other is the onClick on the button. So the onKeyUp is what, as I'm pressing, all right, after I've pressed a key, it goes and it retrieves the values for the dropdown. Now, I could have done this on key down, but it would always be one letter behind. So as I typed in HI, it would show me the words that started with H. And if I typed in HIG, it would show me the words that started with HI, and so on down the line. So the letter doesn't get put really in the text box until you lift the key. That's a good question. If you're ever on Jeopardy and you're on JavaScript events, that would probably be a $500 question, I would think, because that's pretty tricky. When does a character get put in the text box? And it's when you lift the key. So onKeyUp event. All right. So onKeyUp event, I call getWords, and I pass it this dot value. Now, this dot value is sometimes confusing to students. when they see the word this. What does this mean? Yes.
The element, it's contained in.
Yeah, exactly. When it says this, it means whatever element that this instruction is part of. So, this on key up is an event on the text box. So, it's hard to say this without using the word this a bunch of times. But in this particular case, this means the text box itself. Because the code is part of the text box. So if I said this as part of the button, code associated with the button, then this would refer to the button. So this refers to whatever object that piece of code lives at or lives on. And in this particular instance, that code is part of the text box object, text box element. So when I say this.value, I mean the value of the text box. Now, that's sort of a shorthand, right? I could have said, I could have given this an ID and said, get words, document, get element by ID, so on. I could have written this a number of different ways. All right? Or I could have had this function had no argument and appear then in get words, I could have pulled the value of the drop box or of the text box. But I didn't. All right? So essentially what this does is when I lift the key, it calls the function getWords, and it passes the value of the text box to it as an argument. Well, let's see what getWords does. GetWords, first of all, looks to see if there's nothing in the string or the first character is equal to a space. If it's either of those, then it clears out what's there before. How does it clear out what's there before? Well, it grabs a pointer to the dropdown, and it sets the length of the options to 0. So far in this course, we've created HTML dynamically in many cases by using inner HTML. We're going to actually, in this example, explore the DOM a little bit more. And we're going to access other attributes of our HTML elements. So for example, in this case, we're grabbing a dropdown, and dropdowns have a collection of options. All right. One of the attributes of a dropdown is the number of options it has. And if I set the length of the options to 0, that effectively clears out all the options from the dropdown. So this is not an AJAX function. This does not require doing anything to the server. This is something I can handle completely on the client side. Because if there's nothing in the text box, I don't want to show anything in the dropdown. So let me show you what I mean. If I start out and I have something in the text box, as I clear it out, when I clear out the last letter, it totally blanks out the dropdown. And that's this piece of code that does that. I grab a pointer to the dropdown. I then set the length of the number of options to 0. So remember, a dropdown is really a collection of options, right? If you remember what a dropdown looks like, it's a select tag, and there's a whole bunch of option tags nested within the select tag. All I'm saying is change the number of options, the length of that list of options, to 0. So that effectively clears out all the options. Now notice also, And again, sometimes these examples are written at different points in time, so the coding looks a little different. Sometimes I leave the coding different simply to show you that there's more than one way to reference something. Notice that I'm not using the workhorse get element by ID here. All right, I'm saying document FRM math DD words. Well, document, again, means somewhere on the web page. FRM math means part of the form. And then finally, DD words is the name of the dropdown. So I don't have an ID on the dropdown. I refer to it by name. So this is a second way of referring to an element on the page. You can give document dot the name of the form, and then give the name of the form element. Again, just two different ways. Neither of them are superior. It's good to know a couple different ways to do things, though, just in case you're reviewing examples and you see someone doing it one way or another. You know, it would kind of be like, you know, if I were to give an address, you know, if someone were to ask me where is Lorain County Community College, I could give them the address. I could say 1005 Abbey Road, Elyria, Ohio. Or I could give the latitude and longitude, right? It's not pointing to two different colleges. Both those things point to the same college, to the same location. It's just two different ways to refer to a particular point in space. Get element by ID and using the form name and the element name is simply a different way to refer to the dropdown. I could have just as well given that form element an ID and said document get element by ID and then supplied the value of the ID. So in both cases, I am pointing to the dropdown. And specifically, I am setting the length of the dropdown to 0 if there's nothing in the text box. If there is something in the text box, though, I call dictionary1.php and I pass on the query string a value of word and I supply the argument that was entered. What's the argument? Well, the argument, if you remember, is the value of the text box, right? Because when we called this function, we passed it the value of the text box. So if there's nothing in the text box, we clear out the dropdown. If there's something in the text box, we make our AJAX request to dictionary1.php, and we give on the query string with the name of word, we give the value of the text box. I then set the callback function to create DD. So in other words, when the server has responded, create DD gets called, and then I go ahead and actually make that request. So I'm going to I'm going to review some of the debugging techniques. How do I know what gets called from the server to the server? I can put an alert here and say alert and simply display this value. And I can actually see what is getting called on the server. It's important to do debugging techniques like this as opposed to just staring at your code, because otherwise, you can make some pretty wrong assumptions about what's wrong. Don't be so sure that you know what's wrong if your code isn't working, right? A lot of times people think they know what's wrong and head down a certain path in debugging when really the problem is someplace else entirely. So when you're debugging, keep an open mind and verify that stuff is working the way that you think it should, And at some point, you're going to find something that is not working the way that you think it should, and that's where your problem is. So I'm going to go in, and I'm going to move over. This guy to my server. And as I type in a letter, there's my alert showing that what gets called is dictionary1.php word equals A. I type in B and it shows that. So that's what's getting called from the server to the server. All right, I'm going to get rid of that alert because otherwise it'll drive me crazy. Dictionary1.php word equals followed by the string that I've entered in. Let's see what that produces when I call it. Remember, as a debugging technique and as a development technique, I can actually put in the URL up in my browser and see the results that's going to be generated. So, dictionary1.php word equals A. Let's see what gets returned. And we see we get some data. And let's check out the data that we get back from the server. We get back a word followed by a number. And we get back actually a bunch of these. In this case, we have 26 things, actually 27 things we got back. These are all the words that start with A. So, we get back a word, followed by a semicolon, followed by a number. And we'll see what that represents, and we'll see how that gets created in a minute. But just notice now that the word, semicolon, number, colon. So this is the limited data. All right? This actually has two delimiters. It has a colon and a semicolon. The colon is used to separate the list of words. Alright? So, that is one word up to the colon. That is another word. That is a third word. The semicolon is used to separate the word itself from the index of the word, the number of the word. All right? We're going to use that number later on when we pull up the Spanish translation.
So, I just wanted to, so I can make sure I get this straight. So, you're delivering, each cluster has two components, correct?
Yes.
And you're separating each cluster via the colon.
Each cluster is separated by a colon. Within a cluster, the individual fields are separated by semicolons.
So where are you implementing that colon or kind of cluster separation?
Well, we haven't seen that yet.
Okay.
Yeah. yet. We haven't seen that yet. We're just looking at the output. And to just verify that, in fact, that this is the limited data. Because, again, as we can see here, we're getting back data that's separated by special characters, special delimiters. And our next step will be to look to see how this data is created. Our step after that will be to see how it gets parsed to form the dropdown. Okay, so that's the data that we're getting back from the server. Let's look back at the server code. Remember, that's dictionary one. First thing we have in here is we have an include file. Why do we need an include file? Why do we need an include file? What I just did there should have given you a clue as to why we need an include file. How many steps is it to get a translation? Two. Look up the word. Click for the translation. So there's going to be two pieces of server-side code that handle this transaction. One piece gives me the list of words. So as I type in something, it gives me a list of words. So that's one PHP script that does that piece. A second PHP script does this piece. I better make sure that both of those are looking at the same list of words, right? Because if part one had one list of words and part two had a different list of words, then this would never work. All right, so I better make sure that these two are looking at AJAX or server code 1 and server code 2 are looking at the same list of words. So those two things have a list of words in common. Common code in PHP means an include file. So let's look at what the common code is. Let's look at that dictionary.inc. And that dictionary.inc is two arrays. A English and A Spanish. And there's 200 some in each array. This is where I was saying before that I wouldn't want to send all this over via JavaScript. And if you can imagine, if we were going to do a more complete, not just a mathematical terms, but a more complete English to Spanish dictionary, would have many, many more words in here and would probably involve a database. These are what are called parallel arrays. What do I mean by a parallel array? I mean that the array elements line up. So for example, the first English word is absolute value. So that has an index of 0. Because remember, with arrays you start with 0. So absolute value is in the 0 position in the English array. The Spanish translation of it valor absoluto is also in the zero position. So I create these arrays so that the values in the English array correspond to the value in the Spanish array, all the way down the line. So, the second element in the Spanish array is la exactitude. And I know I'm probably butchering the Spanish pronunciation. But element one in the English array is accuracy. Element three in the English array is addition. In the Spanish array, it is la adición. And so on down the line. So that's called parallel arrays, when you have two arrays where the elements of the array line up exactly. So the 10th element in this array matches up with the 10th element in that array. That's called a parallel array. Yes?
Could you make like a class for that and then have the property be like English and then another property be Spanish?
Absolutely. A more full-blown solution, if we were going to do a more robust version of this, we could make a class for mathematical term. And then what we could do is we could have all sorts of attributes for that. We could have the English name for it. We could have the Spanish name for it. We could have the French name for it. We could have a definition in English, Spanish, and French. We could have examples of how it's used, you know, in mathematical expressions, not in words. So, absolutely, if we wanted to do a more involved version of this, you creating classes and integrating with the databases would be the way to go on that. Absolutely. But this is a simple data structure that will get us through a simple example. All right, so now I think we can see what that number is. So in other words, if I go in and type, remember when I pulled up the server-side code, that number is the position in the array. All right, so if I type in R, for example, radius is in position 318 in the array. Root is in 319. Ration is in 320. Rational 321, and so on down the line. So this is returning, when I type in a string, this is returning the English word and the position in the array of the English term, which also happens to be the position in the array of the Spanish version of the word, because those are parallel arrays, and the indexes in those two arrays match up. So let's look at the code that does that. We have our include file with our two arrays. We grab from the query string the request of word. I set a boolean that says we have found none. And I set that to true, right? I'm going to display a special message if some goofy string is typed in and nothing is returned. So if I were to type in something like that, I get a message that says no word matches this pattern and a negative one as the index. What's significant about negative 1? Well, negative 1 doesn't match up with any of the arrays. You start numbering the array with 0. So my code can use the negative 1 as a signal to say negative 1 means that this is not, there are no words to match this string. And we'll see how that comes into in a minute here. So what do? We assume that there's none, and we're going to keep that assumption until we find one. We loop through the English array for I equals 0. That will look at the first element. We do this as long as I is less than the count in A English. So we do this as long as there are more array elements, and we increment I by 1 each time. I then do a comparison, and I use the strpos function. We'll see what that does in a minute. And I'm looking at each element in the English array, and I'm looking for within that array the string that I've typed in the text box. And I'm looking to see if that equals 0. If it does equal 0, and let's forget about the details of what this line of code does for now. This is looking for a match, and I'll explain what this line of code does in a second here. So if there's a match, then I output the English word and the subscript. I put a semicolon between the English word and the subscript. I put a colon after the subscript. So, that's what I output. I loop through. If there's a match, I output the English word, a semicolon, the subscript, and then a colon. And then I repeat this for every element in the list. I then set bNone to false because I have a winner. I have a match. All right. If it makes through the whole loop and it doesn't find any, then I output no words match this pattern and a negative 1. So if I type in something that is not valid, that's what I get.
What if you just type, like, say, A and B, but it's still not bringing back anything as far as just think of absolute values, you just put a B?
If I type in A, B,
yeah.
It okay. Gives me just the one match. Okay. So, we loop through the array. We compare what was typed in the text box with the array element to see if it's a match. If it's a match, we output it, and we set our flag to 0. If we've made it through the whole array and it didn't find any matches, I output that. Now let's look at this instruction in a little more close. This is our condition. Alright. STRPOS is looking for a string in a position. So what this is doing is this is looking at the word in our English array and seeing if the position of the substring is 0. So let's go over a few examples. Let's say my words are absolute value addition and cram. Because this is in a loop, it executes one iteration for each element. Let's say these are my only three words in my array list. If I type in an A, let's add one more. Multiply. If I type in an A, what it's going to do is it's going to try to find a position of A in each of my array items. And it's going to return a number. So where does it find A? Where's the first occurrence of A in absolute value? Very first letter, which you should be used to this by now, is actually not letter number one, but letter zero. So this function, string position, of this word, looking for the substring of A, is going to find the A in position 0. So, I look to see, does that position, where did it find A? Did it find it in position 0? That's what the equal sign says. The position where it found that substring, does that equal to 0? If it does, we have a winner. Now, your eyes are not deceiving you, and I haven't lost my mind because it's Monday or anything. There really are three equal signs here. And we'll come back to what that means in a second. Essentially, it's looking to see if that equals a zero. But I'll explain in a minute why the three equal signs instead of the two. So, string position, in other words, where is the A in the first word? It's in the first letter, which is letter number 0. So that's a match, because the position of A in absolute value, the position of the first A in absolute value, is 0. Where is the position of the first A in addition? Same thing, 0. Where is the position of the A in crab? Yeah, position 0, 1, 2. So position 2. What about in multiply? Nowhere. So this is where PHP gets funky. All right? It actually returns a false, which, if I'm not mistaken, corresponds to a negative 1. But in other words, it didn't find A at all in there. Alright? So, which words are the winners here? Which words are there a match? This one, because the position is 0. This one, because the position is 0. Crab is not, because it found it, but it didn't find it in position 0. So it's not valid. And multiply, it did not find it either. So, it's also a loser. So if these are my two, if this was my list of English words, and I typed in an A, it would give me these two. All right? What if I typed an AB then? Where does it find AB here? Position 0. AB starts in position 0. Where does it find AB here? It doesn't. Where does it find AB here? It's in position 2. Where does it find AB here? False. So, of these values, only one of them equals 0, so we only have one winner. So that way we narrow it down with each step, and we only pick the things that match. So what this does is this finds where this string begins in this string. If it doesn't find it, it returns false. If it finds it, it returns the starting character number starting with 0. So in this case, AB starts in position 0. Here, it's not there at all. Here, AB starts in position 2. Here, it's not there at all. We know we have a match if the starting position is 0, because that means that whatever I've typed in here is right at the beginning of the word, which is what we want if we're looking up a word in a dictionary. If we're looking up a word in the dictionary and it starts with AB, we don't care about crab, because if we wanted to find crab, we'd type in CR, right? So that's how this each time through narrows it down. And then what happens when it has an output? It outputs the word, a semicolon, and the element of the array, this being I0, I1, I2, I3, the position in the list. Now, where do the three equal signs come from? PHP uses equal signs for different things. A single equal indicates an assignment. So if I say x equals 5 times 10, takes 5 times 10, multiplies it, and puts the result in x. So a single equal sign is used for assignment. Two equal signs are used for comparison. So if I were to say if x is equal to 50, then do something, it's going to compare x to 50 and tell me either true or false. Three equal signs are also used for comparison. The difference is with a three equal sign comparison, it has to match the value and the type. All right? In other words, a true or false, you can do a numeric comparison in PHP, and true ends up being like a 1 and false ends up being a 0, or maybe true is a 1 and false is a negative 1, or something like that. PHP actually converts true and false and stuff like that into integers. So if you use the two equal signs, it does a conversion and converts true or false into values, numeric values. If you use the three equal signs, you are saying don't do any conversion. The value has to match, and the type has to be the same. So don't convert a true or false into a number. All right? So effectively, what I'm saying is, it really has to be 0 and not a false that got converted to a 0. All right? So the 0 simply indicates in PHP to do the comparison and pay attention to the type. Don't do any conversion. All right. I look at the time and it is 9:55. All right? So that's where we'll leave off today. All right? So what we have is we sort of have the first part of the server-side code done. We've made the request. We've processed it on the server side and returned back to the client the limited data. What we'll go over next time is this function here, which sort of got into your question, David, of what do we do with that data? And that's what createDD does. CreateDD takes that delimited data and performs an operation called parsing. What is parsing? Parsing is when you take a big string of data and separate it out into its pieces. So we're going to parse that big old string, because what we're getting back from the server, remember, is just a giant string. We have to take that and break it down into the clusters, as you called them, and then break each cluster down into a word and a number. And that's what we do on the client side, and we'll look at that on Wednesday. All right. And I realize now I was just pointing to something on the screen when the screen wasn't up, but you can take a look at the HTML and see that chunk of code, and we'll spend some time on Wednesday reviewing that. All right, see you over in lab.